So the next is 13, right?
Yeah.
What is the question 13?
Bisect squares.
Yeah, bisecting a square. Okay, so can someone explain the question? Let me see if I understood the question right. So this is a completely different genre of questions. So essentially Cartesian coordinates, figuring out where things are in 2D space, right? So there are a few questions in this category. So let's actually walk through some of the basic ones before we figure out what it is. So given two points, right? What is the distance between the two points?
Y2 minus Y1. The whole square.
How do you get this? This is the standard Pythagoras theorem, because you are expecting this to be this, so you want to find that. So this is the delta y, this is the delta x, and that is the square of that. Does it matter if y2 is greater than y1 or y1 is greater than y2?
No, because
you're doing a distance square, right?
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter in that case. So that's why that's how you get this one. What is the slope of this line?
Y2 minus Y1.
Slope of the line is?
Y2 minus Y1. Delta y. X2 minus X1.
Are you sure? Or is it the other way around? The slope essentially is you are defining the line as
mx plus c.
Okay? Where m is the slope. And c is the
constant.
What constant?
The y
intercept. So at any time you draw a line, right? The place at which it crosses the axis, the y at which it crosses the x-axis, because at that time when x is 0, y is equal to c. So that's the point. Okay, so this is essentially 0 comma y, where x is 0, what is the value of y? That is c. So that's what gets you that particular line. Okay, what's wrong with this?
What if it's negative?
What does a negative slope mean?
The other side.
So the slope is essentially, this way, which is like essentially y equal to x equivalent of, so this is a positive slope where m is positive. If it's this way, then m is negative, right? Any other challenges? If it's this way, then m is 0. Because it's like x1 and x2 are the same, right? The perfectly vertical line has got a slope where m is infinity. And so if you do this mathematically, you will actually run into issues. So there are, if you are actually into, you know, plotting a line on a screen, right? You want to draw stars to show, like, I want to draw this line, right? So what you want to do is, most common way of doing it is that essentially you'll say for x equals minimum x to maximum x, and then you would say y equals mx plus c, then you would say plot at x comma y. You can do that. The problem with this is that if your x is like, if it's like a line which is something like this, right, then what you'll do is you'll plot one line, one dot here, and one dot here, and that's it. That doesn't look like a line. So what you need to do is depending on if your slope is better than 45, if it's actually less than 45 degrees, then this approach makes sense. If your slope is higher than 45 degrees, essentially if your slope is in this range, then it makes sense to iterate over y and then find the x corresponding to that. So which means you will actually create a different formula where x equals a different equation where x equals m prime y plus c prime. So where you're actually saying c is this intercept, on the c prime is this intercept, and the m prime is different, so in which case it's essentially m will be, m prime will be 0 for vertical and m prime will be infinity for horizontal. So you could do that, right? So that's the basic math behind behind this. So knowing this is essential to solve these kinds of questions. Now, I haven't seen geometry-oriented questions in a long while. At this point, like multiple years now, I've been through a lot of interviews. I haven't seen any of these questions come up. There was one question that I heard Google asking a few years ago. I was told it's Google. I have no personal experience there. But the question that was actually asked was, I stand corrected, there's one question I've seen which is not necessarily geometry related, but the Google one was that. So the question is that you're actually given a circle and you are given a rectangle. Okay? Now tell me if they intersect or not. I give you the coordinates of the circle and I give you the coordinates of the rectangle. Tell me if they intersect or not. How do you define the coordinate of a circle? What do you need for a coordinate of a circle? So if I give you center, which is essentially x, y, and I give you radius, which is r, I'm good, right? Any questions that you can actually get the circle? Is there any ambiguity with this?
No.
Okay, what about rectangle?
The 4 points or maybe.
Do you need all the four?
Three.
Okay, so how many of you think that with 1 point you can figure it out?
1 point.
With just 1 point. Just 1 point.
You need like width and height.
Yeah.
Which 1 point width and height is okay?
No.
So orientation.
2 points.
No, we need 2 points.
Two diagonal points at least.
Yeah, two diagonal
points. So if I give you this diagonal points, this is one rectangle and this is the other rectangle. They're two different rectangles.
Oh yes.
So why? What's the difference? 2 points is not enough. The reason is that you need the orientation, right? So there is the thing is that if it's an orthogonal, if you're given there is an orthogonal rectangle, then 2 points make sense because it's already orthogonal. If I actually flip it over, then it's no longer orthogonal. So yes, as long as you're told the orientation to some extent, you need that information. Okay, so the easiest thing for you to do is that, you know, give me all the four values and I'm done. 3 is more than enough because you can always infer the fourth value based on the 3. So 3 points is essential. Okay. Now, so that's you need 3 points. So let's assume I give you the 4 points. Okay. So what needs to happen is the Google question was essentially figure out if it's intersecting or not. So one of the things that we had actually thought of in this one is the first thing is that the answer does not change. You can do what is called translation. Translation is essentially moving something in lateral space where you move all the values. So instead of the origin being here, if I change the origin to be here, does that change the equation?
No.
Not at all, right? So let's translate it, which means that you will subtract or add the same values to x, y and all the points in the on the rectangle. So that's the step one that you do. Okay, that eliminates a lot of complexities. Then you don't have to figure out the left half of the circle, right half circle. That's not required. Okay, that's number one. Number two is that at this point, if I rotate this, right? If I rotate this in such a way that this now becomes orthogonal to the axis. Okay, does that change my answer?
No.
It doesn't. How do you do rotation? How do you rotate? Translation is easy. X minus this, y minus that. Awesome. How do you rotate?
What did you rotate
the exactly? I rotate the whole board, right? If I just rotate the whole board.
So the axis itself changes then, the way you're...
So I have new axis. So rotation implies that the axis remains the same, the object has moved. Right? Or the axis has moved, whichever way you look at it.
If the object has moved, then you've actually changed the position of the things, right? You've actually changed the position of where they are.
But does it change the answer? Does it change the intersections or not? What intersected before, will it continue to intersect?
Okay.
What didn't intersect, will it continue to not intersect? Right, that remains the same, right? So if I have something like this, okay, if I just rotate it this way so that this line now aligns with my wanted horizontal, then that essentially makes my rectangle align to the orthogonal, the axis, the new axis. So how do you rotate? So the rotation is a lot easier in which coordinate system?
Z.
In? No, Cartesian coordinate system is one coordinate system, the other coordinate system is?
Angle.
Polar.
Yeah, angles theta.
Long ago, right? So if you translate these points into polar coordinates, then all you're doing is just changing the angle. Right? Once you change the angle, it remains the same, everything remains the same. You can translate it back to Cartesian system and then you'll get new values for these points. Okay? At that point, you can actually just ignore and just use these two points and then you can make your answers with that. Because once you have translated it into, once you have made it orthogonal, once you have translated a center, rotation, what does rotation do to a circle?
Nothing,
because the circle is essentially, it's a circle, right? So it doesn't do anything to that. So the only coordinate that will be affected is that. So let's assume you're able to translate and you're able to rotate. Which one would you do first, translation or rotation?
Translation.
Why? How does it matter?
So
these operations are independent, right? So you can actually, what would have happened if you had translated? You would have had, then if you translated, then you would have to also, if you had to rotate first, then the x and y of the circle will also move, right? So what I'm saying is that I could take this equation, which is like this, and rotate it around this axis and make it this way, that's good, right? Or I could go like this, rotate it first, right? And then translate it as much as required to go there. So it wouldn't matter, whichever you do first, right? Except that the problem is that when you rotate and you convert from polar coordinates to Cartesian coordinates and back, there is always going to be some error because you are it's floating point numbers. So the minimum changes you do, the better. Since the circle is already given to you in Cartesian coordinate system, it makes sense to do the translations first because then you'll be accurate in terms of the translation and then do the rotation. When you do the rotation, you got the imprecise Cartesian coordinate, like polar coordinate to back to Cartesian coordinate. It makes it a little harder, but that's where we are. Okay, so done with that. Now you need to find out whether this intersects or not. Now the intersection can be in many different ways, where the entire rectangle is completely contained with this, the circle encompasses the rectangle, or the rectangle encompasses the circle, or it overlaps. It's a bunch of different rules and systems, and that I think is not where I was where I want to take this. But this is one question I heard a few years back. It's like almost 5-6 years back. I saw this as a question that was asked in Google interviews. Sounded more like a problem solving question than a coding question per se, and I haven't seen that being asked since then. The other question which I've seen actually more recently was around given two rectangles, tell me if they overlap or not. And that seems to be a more given two orthogonal rectangles, they both are aligned to the axis, tell me if they intersect or not. And that is essentially where it's a very simple mathematical thing of is y one, the only way it works is essentially if the y's have to intersect, like the minimum of y, maximum of y, the other y's has to be somewhere in between the two, or vice versa. So it's a very simple question, so we'll, that's not, it's got nothing to do with the coordinate geometry, so I just let it go, okay? Now on to our current question. So you are given two rectangles. To start with, let's assume that the rectangles are actually aligned with the axis, which means that I have a rectangle, and I have another square, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, fine, two squares. The question that is given is that draw a line that actually cuts the square into equal halves. So one of the, how many ways can you cut a square in equal halves? Or do you see even one square? So that's one way. Any other way? That's another way. Any other way?
Diagonal.
Two diagonals. Any other way? Four ways. Any other way?
Infinite way.
It is just infinite way.
Doesn't matter. As long as you cut it passing through the center, you can always cut it. Okay? So, because the delta here is identical to the delta here, so whatever is this, right? So you will essentially be forming a trapezoidal space, orthogonal trapezoid, so where one, this is 90 degrees, and the other image is essentially just like a flip of this, and that should be pretty straightforward, right? So this is one of the basic opposite angles are equal axioms, so you should be able to get that going. So that you can do that. Now, so there's an infinite number of lines that actually intersect, that actually cut the square into two, and there's an infinite number of lines that cut that into square into two. What is the, how many lines can actually cut both the squares into?
One.
Always?
No, if the both center are same, then infinite.
If both squares are overlapping, or the centers of the squares are same, because the only rule is that this has to be passing to the center, and that line has to pass through that center. which means that the line that you draw, which cuts, which goes through this center and that center, is the one that actually cuts the two. And how many ways can you draw a line segment, a line that passes through two points? Only one way, unless those two points are exactly overlapping, in which case any line that you draw through that one of them will go through the other one as well, right? So if you, unless you have a square which is like that, right, with the center overlapping, it doesn't even have to be identical squares. We just have to be.
It can even be parallel, right? And the centers are like in the same line. Even
then there's only one line.
Oh yeah.
As long as the centers are different, there's only two. There are two distinct points. As long as there are two distinct points, you can draw that, right? So that's what it is. So now the question here is to find the line that actually passes through both the centers. That's as simple as this question is. So you need to definitely make sure that there's only one way of doing it. So you just have to check the center. You're given the coordinates of the circle of the square. So you need to how many ways do you need the how many coordinates do you need for to define a square in space?
One coordinate and length, otherwise two coordinates.
Even if it's not orthogonal.
Square.
If it's not given not to be orthogonal, it may not be orthogonal.
Oh, then
the two diagonal points should also do.
Will it do?
You can't really flip it over.
Yeah. Even if you flip it, the same thing.
Yeah.
For a rectangle, yeah. If I flip this over, right, yeah. It forms a different image, different shape. Yeah. But if it's square, then even if I flip it across that axis, right, it's still the same. So for square, only diagonals are, the two diagonals are adequate.
Diagonals.
So if, as long as you can give me the diagonals, whichever ones, doesn't matter, you can figure out. And by exchanging the coordinates of x and y, you can actually find the other things as well if it's orthogonal. If it's not orthogonal, then you have to figure out more magic to get there. Okay? All right. So let's assume that I gave you the coordinates of the diagonals. How do you find the center?
The difference of x by 2 and difference of y by 2.
It's a midpoint, right? So essentially you draw the line between the two and you find the exact midpoint of that. It's x1 plus x2 by 2 and y1 plus y2 by 2, and that gives you the midpoint. I got the midpoint. Now what's the next step? Find if they are the same or not, because we just talked about that. We said we have to make sure. If it's the same, then what do you do? We are screwed. We can't draw a line. Sorry. If it's not the same, then what do we do? Then we say that that's the answer. So you can definitely draw the y equals mx plus c. You can figure out what is that line that passes through both the centers. We can do that. Done. Now what next? And that this line bisects the squares. Clearly we got the answer. But here is the fun part of it, right? Which is what the book also tries to get to. Saying, what if instead of actually saying I want to give you the line, give me the line segment that actually does that. What's the difference between a line and a line segment? A line actually is infinite, it passes through infinity, it's long, right? A line segment actually is finite distance, so I want you to identify that point, and I want you to identify this point. Okay? So which is essentially, where does this line intersect the square? Can a line intersect a square in more than one side?
Yes.
By definition, it will. Right? Because if you draw a line, it has to intersect this side and this side. Okay, can it intersect more than two sides?
No.
Are you sure?
If it is diagonal,
well, if it's passing through the center, then...
Passing through the center is fine.
If it's one of the sides.
Hmm?
If it's one of the sides.
No, but then it will not pass through the center.
So it'll pass through, like drawing a line which passes through the center. So this line that we draw, right? Which is passing through the center. I mean, of course, if you have a line that is parallel to this, it will not intersect anything. That is clear. And if it's like, that we understand. If it's parallel and it's away from the square, then it's not going to pass through anything. So that is clear. But what I'm saying is that if you know that the line passes through the center, then how many sides can it intersect? It will intersect two sides, we know. But can it intersect more than two sides?
No.
If it's going through the edge, maybe.
Yeah, the diagonal.
It's going through the diagonal point.
So what if it passes through the vertex?
Yes.
Vertex.
Then what does it mean? This vertex is a part of both the lines, right?
Yeah.
So if it's a part of both the lines, so if you draw a line which is actually passing through the center and passing through one vertex, it will pass through the other vertex too. When it does that, how many lines is it actually technically intersecting? It's intersecting all the four lines.
Yeah.
Because it is passing through, an intersection is defined as, does this point occur on that line, right? And the answer is yes. because this vertex point appears on both lines. This vertex point appears on both lines. So it's all the four. Not passing through the center, if this line is actually on this, right, then how many lines is it intersecting? Three. Because is it not only is it on this, overlapping this, it's also intersecting these two lines, technically, right? So so that's it. So now, so the goal is for you to find out the point of intersection. Okay? How do you find the point of intersection? How many points of intersection are there?
In this case, it will be two.
Always. Two or four, right? You don't know, but two.
I mean, 2 points that pass through the square.
Per square.
Because it is going all through the center square.
There's 2 points, correct.
Yeah.
So the line segment will end at a point.
Yeah.
The line segment will end at a point. That point could be on this line, or that point could be here,
yeah.
Or the point could be exactly on the vertex. It could be one of the three scenarios, but that's where we are, okay? And how do you figure that out? How do you figure out where that point is? Mathematically, how do you figure it out? So you know the equation of the line, right? I have the equation of the line, okay? I have all the four coordinates, like x1, ax1, ay1, ax2, ay2, there's a square, a is boundaries, then bx1, by1, bx2, by2. I have all the four, and I have y equals mx plus c. I have this. With these values, how do I find out this point and how do you find out that point?
So find the equation
of
that line and then see where this line intersects that,
mm-hmm. That line. So what you can do is you can actually figure out where the line that you're looking at is intersecting the vertical and the horizontal lines. All the four of them for all practical purposes. So let me draw this again so that if you have it this way. Right? And you have the line like this, right? Then you can extend this. This is point number one, where this line intersects the bottom edge, which is outside the square. And this line intersects it, which is inside the square. And this line intersects it, which is inside the square. And this line intersects it, that's outside the square. So there are four points where this line will intersect the four lines of the thing. In certain scenarios, it might be that this and this intersect exactly at the same spot, so you may not have four values, you may just have one, and you may have just one there, that is fine. Then what you need to do is you need to figure out if this point is actually in the square or on the square or not. And once you figure that out, how do you figure out if a line is in the square, if the point is in the intersection point is within the square or not?
This one, the x, y.
You just have to make sure that it's within these two x's.
Yeah.
For this line, if it's between these two x's, then it's within the square. If it's not, it's not. Oh, it's out. For this line, it's between these two y's. If yes, then it's there. So with that math, you'll be able to figure out that these two are the contenders and not the outside two. Okay? If it had been passing through the center and through the vertices, then you will essentially find these 2 points. I mean, all the 4 points will essentially collapse to two, and both the points will be on both the lines, so you're good to go anyway. So you'll be able to get that. Once you get that, what do you do? What's next? How do you know this guy or that guy?
Essentially, we got 4 points.
So you got 4 points. So you get 2 points this way, and on the other square, since it's extended, you got this point and this point, right? Now, what do you need to do?
Minimum point and the maximum.
Minimum point. What is minimum?
Minimum on x. I don't know.
Yeah, they are orthogonal, so you can just look at
them. I'm not entirely sure, so I want to make sure. Let's walk through this. Go ahead. Right, conversation. Go on.
Minimum.
I have got these 4 points, right? How do I know which 2 points I need to keep and which 2 points I need to ignore?
Minimum, x, and max.
Will that always work?
No, there will be some point like it is y as well. So. So the same image can be on y side. So
how about the same thing, right?
But in that case, it will be minimum y and minimum maximum.
But minimum y is the minimum x anyways, or maximum x. Like if this line had been sloping this way, your minimum x is maximum x. In the other case, it's the same thing, right? Doesn't matter. So instead of that, right, had it been this way, the line would be like this.
Yeah.
Right.
Again.
So in that case, also it's minimum x and maximum x. Only thing is it's maximum y and minimum y, and minimum y and maximum y.
If For vertical and horizontal, we have to.
That is the challenge. So if you don't just assume that just because it's drawn this way doesn't mean that's how it always works. What if this damn thing was up and down like this? What if you had this? There is no minimum x. All the four have x of what? 0. Now what?
Then y.
So then in this case you do minimum y and maximum y and you got the answer. I mean you still get it. So essentially it is the it's either the minimum x or maximum x. If you were to, if all the four x's are the same, then you can use the minimum y and maximum y. If all the four y's are the same, then you use minimum x. And if all the four are different, then it doesn't matter which one you pick, it's you're fine. Okay? So that's the technical answer, and you can write it in a different way to say I'll do minimum x, maximum x, unless if the x's are different, that's what I will do. If the x's are same, then I'll just pick the min x and min y and max y. Questions? It's not a great interview question per se. I don't even know why it's in the moderate category, but looking at how we are all struggling with this, I think the thing is that we are not familiar with these coordinate geometry concepts, and that causes issues.